This week, attention was brought to Earth's only natural satellite, as India successfully landed an unmanned probe, including a lunar rover vehicle, on the moon. And that brings to mind the Apollo 15 mission, which 52 years ago this month was the first to operate a motorized vehicle on the moon. While only four of the two-seat electric roadster that the press dubbed the moon buggy were ever created, it is by far the most popular car model on the planetary body on which it was designed to drive. And one that the people who drove it said changed everything. The history of NASA's lunar roving vehicle deserves to be remembered. Well before the technology that might make a human visit to the moon possible, writers of science fiction realized that the moon was large enough that any astronaut who wished to visit any significant portion of it would need transportation, and that transportation on the moon would offer unique challenges. In a 1995 issue of the Journal of the British International Planetary Society, Betty Burkhalter and Mitchell Sharp noted that the idea for a vehicle that would transport man on the surface of the moon, like other technological realities in contemporary astronautics, had its conceptual beginnings in the imagination of the writers of science fiction in the early years of the 20th century. These writers offered many fanciful versions of moon transportation, some of which would come to fairly resemble plans that were made as a human visit to the moon moved from the realm of science fiction to real possibility. In a series of articles in the 1950s in Collier's magazine, rocket scientist Wernher von Braun, then with the U.S. Army Ballistic Missile Agency, outlined a plan for a six-week manned mission to the moon that included lunar vehicles. Von Braun's ideas for lunar vehicles included pressurized cabins, moved on caterpillar-like tractor treads, and would have weighed around 10 tons. Von Braun emphasized the need for such a vehicle in a 1964 edition of Popular Science. The visible part of the moon extends over an area twice the size of the United States, and the far side of the moon is just as large. Work on a practical design for such a vehicle began in 1959. Burkhalter and Sharp explained that in 1959, the U.S. Army Ordnance Missile Command in Huntsville completed a study for a manned base on the moon, given the codename Project Horizon. The task of developing a manned lunar rover was assigned to the Transportation Corps. It was to have a pressurized cabin with accommodations for a crew of two. The Horizon rover would have weighed some 900 kilograms and been powered by rechargeable electric batteries. In 1960, the Army Ballistic Missile Agency was transitioned into the NASA Marshall Space Center, and research and development on moon vehicles continued. A 2021 article on the website of the Smithsonian Institution's National Air and Space Museum noted that Wernher von Braun thought that the LM itself might be used as a lunar taxi. One contractor proposed a hovercraft, another pushed a lunar worm that would snake its way over the moon's broken surface. A Stanford scientist beat the drum for a lunar leaper, which amounted to a giant pogo stick. NASA mulled a lunar motorcycle, too. But the focus was still on heavy designs that included pressurized cabins, mostly working on the idea that they would operate from a lunar base. Such an idea was ambitious. Author Earl Swift told Florida NPR station WUWF in 2021. Anything that large would require a second Saturn V rocket to deliver it to the moon. Burkhalter and Sharp write that these proposals were based upon a dual-launch Apollo lunar module, i.e. after the astronauts had landed on the moon, their lunar module would arrive via an unmanned vehicle. This idea went as far as a prototype. A 2002 NASA publication, A Brief History of the Lunar Roving Vehicle, writes that the Marshall Center started lunar surface vehicle research in 1964 with a concept known as MOLAB, for Mobile Laboratory, a two-man, three-ton, closed-cabin vehicle with a range of 100 kilometers. Studies were conducted by General Motors, Boeing, Bendix Corporation, and Grumman under contract to the Marshall Space Flight Center. The website Gizmodo explains, rather than try to stuff a fortnight's worth of oxygen and supplies into a spacesuit, NASA developed the MOLAB, a roving laboratory that doubled as an artificial habitat for astronauts in the field. Development of the MOLAB began in 1963 as an Apollo logistics support system. GM designed and constructed the mobile lab over the course of the next year under contract with NASA. The website of General Motors talks about the project. GM completed the MOLAB in 1964 for NASA's use in the Apollo astronaut program. NASA used MOLAB for 7 years, developing moon suits for the Apollo astronauts who actually trained and drove MOLAB in the New Mexico desert. There was a mock-up vehicle, a test of concept that included components that would be not practical in an actual lunar environment. Notably, the GM MOLAB was powered by a modified Corvair engine. But there was a problem. at a total cost of nearly $6.5 billion, or around $37 billion 2021 dollars, the Saturn V rockets were by far the largest cost involved in the Apollo program, with a cost per launch of around $185 million, or about $1.3 billion in 2023 dollars. The additional launches were simply too expensive. After a production run of 15 launch-capable Saturn Vs, a second production run was canceled, along with ambitious plans for a lunar base. Gizmodo notes, a shortage of these rockets in the late 1960s eliminated the only off-world route these rovers could take. The GM Molab didn't, however, go to waste, Gizmodo continues. But rather than simply scrap the Molab prototype it already had, NASA instead loaned it out to the United States Geological Survey, which used it for a number of groundbreaking geological studies throughout the American Southwest. The prototype is now housed at the U.S. Space and Rocket Center in Huntsville, Alabama. The lack of rockets didn't just end the Molab project. It ended the entire idea that the Apollo program would include a rover, WUWF explains. But in the late 60s, NASA's budget was cut, and they abandoned the idea of having a rover during the Apollo missions. But, they continue, that didn't stop engineers in private companies from continuing their research. When Apollo 11 launched on July 16, 1969, just one day after my fifth birthday, astronauts Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin had nothing but their own two legs to carry them on the surface of the moon. Swift noted on the website of the National Air and Space Museum, despite the fun they seemed to be having as we watched them bunny hop over the surface on TV, it was hard work. All that limited the astronauts' range from base and the time they could spend outside the lunar module. But an issue was raised when Apollo 12 astronauts Pete Conrad and Alan Bean found difficulty not only in the limitations on distance traveled, but the difficulty in carrying the equipment necessary to gather samples and do experiments. Apollo 13, of course, never landed on the moon, but for Apollo 14, NASA had an answer. The Modular Equipment Transporter, or MET. The MET was a two-wheeled vehicle that the astronauts nicknamed the Rickshaw. The NASA operator's manual describes the MET's role. Small items of crew and scientific equipment are stowed on the MET to free the astronaut from the cumbersome crew activities required if carrying this equipment by hand. Items carried on the MET included cameras and film, a portable magnetometer, geology hand tools, and it had a workspace. The MET used rubber tires, the first tires to be used on the moon, designed and built by Goodyear and filled with nitrogen, and was pulled by a single handle. The transporter weighed 30 Earth pounds, but had an impressive capacity of 340 Earth pounds, and, according to its operational specifications, could be pulled between 4 and 7 miles per hour. Not only did the MET itself turn out to be something of a disappointment, Swift noted in his book Across the Airless Wilds that the MET worked so poorly on uneven ground that astronauts Alan Shepard and Edgar Mitchell eventually had to pick it up and carry it. Moreover, traversing distances on the moon proved to be generally more difficult than anticipated, and terrain was deceptive. Even with the help of the MET and its Goodyear tires, Shepard and Mitchell were unable to fulfill a significant mission objective of collecting samples from the rim of Cone Crater, just a half mile from the lunar module. But an alternative would be available in time for the next mission. In May of 1969, NASA had issued a request for proposal for a manned lunar rover vehicle. While NASA had previously given up on the idea of a lunar rover, there had been significant lessons learned during the previous projects, including Molab, and research had continued outside of NASA. Notably, an engineer at Boeing named Frank Pavlix had developed an idea for a lightweight, open-top vehicle that could be folded and carried in a compartment aboard the lunar module. Swift told WUWF, "It weighed next to nothing. It was minimalist, but it was a pretty viable idea." So Pavlix made a 1/6 scale model of it, and he and his boss Sam Romano took it to Huntsville, Alabama, to the Marshall Space Flight Center, where Vander Von Braun was the director. They showed it to him, and legend has it that he slammed his fist down on the desk and said, "We must do this!" And the rest is history. There were many obstacles to overcome in the design of what would become the Lunar Roving Vehicle, or LRV, which would be constructed by Boeing and General Motors. Swift notes that it was called on to cross country that no Earth car would encounter, in conditions that would cripple any terrestrial vehicle instantly. Temperatures of minus 250 degrees Fahrenheit in the shade and plus 250 in the sunshine. A surface of clingy, abrasive dust that could foul any moving part. Fierce solar radiation and a constant shower of micrometeoroids, smaller than grains of sand but moving faster than bullets. All wrapped in an airless vacuum. And the National Air and Space Museum notes, things got radical when the Marshall Center laid down a hard and fast requirement. The rover couldn't weigh more than 400 pounds, or about the weight of a single astronaut in his spacesuit. But perhaps the most daunting difficulty, the museum website continues, from the point they won the contract, Boeing and GM had 17 months to deliver the first rover for Apollo 15. At a minimum, Apollo hardware typically took twice as long to develop. Swift explains that the aggressive timetable could only be met because of what had been learned in previous projects, such as MOLAB. Notably, MOLAB had used wire mesh wheels. Such wheels would collapse under Earth pressure and yet could carry far more weight under the moon's gravity than the rubber wheels used on the Met. A September 2009 NASA report entitled "The Development of Wheels for the Lunar Roving Vehicle" explained that, because of the unique lunar environment, the creation of flexible wheels was the most challenging and time-consuming aspect of the LRV development. The LRV Operations Handbook explains that each wheel includes an open-wire mesh tire with chevron tread covering 50% of the surface contact area. The tire inner frame prevents excessive deflection of the outer wire mesh frame under high-impact load conditions. The tire is made of a woven mesh of zinc-coated piano wire to which titanium treads were riveted in a chevron pattern. Additionally, Swift notes that based on their experience with MOLAB, Boeing had likewise experimented with the electrical motors and harmonic drive transmissions that drove the rover. Each wheel would be powered by an independent, 1/4 horsepower electric motor, although the vehicle could operate on only 3 or 2 of these motors if some were to malfunction. Despite, however, having learned lessons and done much development work previously, Swift adds that, even so, it took a Herculean effort to meet the deadline and more than twice as much money as expected. The vehicle could successfully operate on a single horsepower and mesh tires because gravity on the moon is only 1/6 that of the Earth. This also allowed a minimalist design that fit the weight and size parameters needed to fit the LRV onto the LM. But this offered its own problem, as the LRV wouldn't be able to operate in Earth's gravity. An astronaut in a fully loaded spacesuit would crush the LRV here on Earth. For testing and training, Boeing and GM had to create an Earth version that was exactly 6 times stronger to account for the difference. Earth testing and training was done at many sites, including Nevada, California, and New Mexico. Maybe most spectacularly, the National Air and Space Museum notes, USGS also blew craters into a volcanic cinder field outside Flagstaff, Arizona, to create a fairly accurate analog for what the astronauts would encounter while motoring on the moon. The NASA website explains the LRV controls. A T-shaped hand controller situated between the two seats controlled the 4 drive motors, 2 steering motors, and brakes. Moving the stick forward powered the LRV forward. Left and right turned the vehicle left or right. Pulling backwards activated the brakes. Activating a switch on the handle before pulling back would put the LRV into reverse. Pulling the handle all the way back activated a parking brake. Yet another issue had become clear during the extravehicular mission on Apollo 14. Distances on the moon can be deceptive without easy points of reference. Traveling in the LRV, astronauts might easily get lost. Swift told WUWF, "They did devise this pretty ingenious system that measured where you were in relation to a starting point. At the beginning of each drive, Mission Control in Houston and the astronauts on the moon would agree as to where they were on the moon's surface. And as the astronauts drove, inside their control console were electronics that married a directional gyro, which keeps track of where the nose of the rover was pointed, and odometers in each of the wheels. By keeping track of where you are headed and how far you go in that direction, the astronauts always knew where they were and where they were headed, where the lunar module was in relation to where they were, and what was the fastest route back to the lunar module if they ran into trouble." All in all, the LRM, for all its focus on minimalist design, was an extraordinary piece of engineering. While the press liked to use the term moon buggy, Frank Pavlik found the term dismissive, saying that the LRV was more like designing a spacecraft on wheels. Motoring on the moon did offer significant challenges, Swift told the National Air and Space Museum. The rover's light weight and extremely short wheelbase, combined with the moon's broken surface and 1/6 gravity, pretty much guaranteed a wild ride. Jim Irwin, who rode shotgun in the Apollo 15 rover, likened it to a bucking bronco and to a small boat in choppy seas. Apollo 16's Charlie Duke told me it was squirrely and fishtailed like a car on an icy road. All the crews professed thanks for their seat belts. Irwin and Scott memorably said on national television, "This is a rock and rolling ride." NASA worried about reliability. NASA wouldn't allow astronauts to take the LRV farther away from the lunar module than they could walk back if it broke down. In general, the LRV would be driven to the edge of that distance first, and then astronauts would work their way back. Thus, the distance that astronauts could travel for experiments was still limited. However, the only significant maintenance issue that occurred was on Apollo 17 mission, when astronaut Eugene Cernan accidentally bumped the rover with a hammer handle and broke off a fender extension. In true NASA form, repairs were effected using duct tape. Despite the limits of the LRV, its capabilities dramatically expanded the science that could be done on a lunar mission. Swift told WUWF, during Apollo 11, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin walked an area that was smaller than a football field. Could fit all of their wanderings into a football field and have a lot of yardage left over. On the last mission, on Apollo 17, Gene Cernan and Jack Schmidt drove more than 22 miles, and at one point they were very close to 5 miles away from their lunar module. Boeing and GM produced 4 LRVs, definitely one of the smaller production runs for a General Motors model. The program was discontinued when further Apollo missions were canceled, partly because of competition for funds with the growing war in Vietnam. The one LRV still here on Earth is on display at the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex, and 3 of the ones that were built to test here on Earth have also been preserved, and of course there are 3 LRVs still up there on the moon, although scientists say that their batteries would be drained and that solar radiation has likely degraded essential components. Research and development of the LRV affected other technologies, for example, the design of electric wheelchairs, and lessons learned with the LRV project continue to be applied in the unmanned rovers that we use in space today. And of course, there's a chance that we might see another version of an LRV, as NASA has never given up on the idea of returning to the moon. But the legacy of the spaceship on wheels is as timeless as the moon itself. Swift notes that the LRV so transformed our ability to make scientific use of the enormous investment of the Apollo program that, the fact is, the lunar rover changed everything. I hope you enjoyed watching this episode of The History Guy, and if you did, please feel free to like and subscribe and share The History Guy with your friends. And if you also believe that history deserves to be remembered, then you can support The History Guy as a member on YouTube, a supporter on our community and locals, or as a patron on Patreon. You can also check out our great merchandise shop or book a special message from The History Guy on Cameo.